old friend of mine and well-known writer in Greece, Nikos Dimou, who also dedicated a posting on his blog for me once about my adventures in America. And he had actually helped me become a columnist in the magazine, the computer magazine RAM. For 1 year I had two columns, in the front and the last in the back of the magazine, which at the time was the top magazine of computers in Greece, while I was here in America in my first years. He had at some point in his life a few years of very brilliant small novels that were very educational to one's life. One of them is called, which is now also official educational material in schools in Greece, The Man Who Was Preparing His Car. And the novel talks about a man who loved his car and was always keeping it in top shape and always ready for the big trip. And he was always dreaming about that big trip, whether it would be in Africa or in Europe or in America or in Asia, and was always maintaining and keeping his car in excellent shape, even through the years of his marriage and everything. And at the end, of course, he got old and died, and they found his car in the garage, packed with tools and replacement parts and food. And they were wondering, what was he doing with all that stuff? The moral of the story, for both drivers and photographers, is first book the activity or the trip, and then worry about the gear. Because you can find gear everywhere, but you won't find missed years of your life anywhere. Because quite a few people nowadays, they buy gear just in case I need this lens, and that case never appears. And it just increases the cost, which is already very high, and it makes the whole thing too heavy to carry around, and it discourages us from actually making the case of going somewhere, of doing something. There were three eye-openers for me for making me go the minimalistic route aggressively lately, and also not to worry about gear. The first two, you will see them later in this video, because I have already made those parts. The third one was the last one that happened last week, when I told you that instead of taking a 35 and a 125 to the Botanic Gardens, I accidentally took with me a 135 and a 125. And guess what? It resulted to 15 keepers, out of which 5 prints, 2 of which will be printed massively for the entire family. Now this is a little bit of a long video, and I don't want to waste your time, you can just watch it in the background, I guess. But it has some structured parts in there that I think that many of you will find valuable. The factors that drive up the cost of digital photography. Why gear minimalism actually works. What's an ideal structure of spending in the hobby of photography? Where should the money go? And what are the three questions that I ask myself to avoid spending money on things that I don't need? Free88 writes, "The shields make sure to keep the water muddy." I wouldn't necessarily call them shields, but they are salespeople. And when you call them salespeople, that's the correct quantification and qualification of the issue, and that's how you avoid traps. You don't go to every store out there and try to be convinced by salespeople, but all the way to the end of the video, I will show what is actually happening. So when Chelsea switched from Nikon to Sony, that was legitimate, because she had about a year, right, to do side-by-side tests, to try both systems, and she presented a boatload of valid reasons, like the one is more light, I have this and that lens, and blah, 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 and what have you. But switch from Sony to Canon, with the R5 pretty much still in the box, no, that doesn't fly. And making a video about it, that doesn't fly at all. There is not a long side-by-side test procedure, not even a usability study after months and months of shooting and this and that. And to say that, look, it nails 99% of a bird's eyes or 100% doesn't fly at all in her case. Because with Mark Smith being published on Amazon Prime with a D500 and a 200 to 500, which is the cheapest long lens of Nikon, a zoom lens that it's a 5.6 zoom, nobody can convince me that they are so passionate about birds that they absolutely need the most new, most expensive gear out there. If I were so passionate about exotic birds, the first thing that I would do, having an internet-based business, would be to move to Florida. My first concern would not be the gear, but go where the birds are. I wouldn't be like, oh, this camera is the best for photographing the blue of the sea. That's why I'm buying it and I recommend it to everybody. Where do you live, by the way? Idaho. Doesn't make any sense. That video of hers was the strongest turning point of all. It solidified the opinion that we're not watching honest gear reviews, but simply recommendations to buy another camera right after the other, and so on and so forth, which has made digital photography exponentially more expensive than film photography.
I woke up one day and I was like, I don't like anything about this process. I don't like these cameras. I don't like the fact that my entire life is tied to the computer. I suddenly went from paying a lab to do the work that the lab was paid to do, process my film, scan my film, etc. When I'd be off doing other things, I could be cycling, I could be meeting with photographers, I could be doing research. Suddenly I was everything, day after day after day on the computer. And I said, I don't want to do this anymore.
So here are the problems with digital photography. New gear all the time.
When people went to digital, there was this idea that digital was cheaper because there was no film and processing cost. But the exact opposite was the truth. Digital was far more expensive to shoot than film because you had cameras that were 10 times the price that didn't last long, that constantly had to be upgraded. You had software, you had firmware, you had hard drives, you had all the time at the computer. I was charging $300 an hour. And when you start spending 8 or 10 hours a day on the computer, you are going backwards financially.
The second and biggest problem, though, is that every manufacturer has his own color profiles and white balance measurements embedded in the camera, and they keep them proprietary. Now, in the past, you would buy a camera that was a lot cheaper than today's digital cameras, a lot cheaper. Everybody could afford the camera and a couple of lenses. And then you would choose from films, and every film had a specific look that was dictated by the film chemistry itself and by the developing process. And in the developing process, if you took them to any commercial lab out there, their machines were exactly tuned for that specific development process. So you knew exactly what to expect. Nowadays, you don't even know what to expect from shot to shot with the same camera and the same lens in the same exact location just by changing the aperture. Because in the old days, to get a camera and two great lenses, about $800, and not very old days, like 90s, you know, or 80s, and 40 films, to include also the missed shots, by $11 the professional grade film, and 1,000 prints at your local dedicated photography lab, your total cost for your entire family legacy in 5x7s will be $3,240. And the only time you spent was actually taking the pictures. You see, if there was something magical in modern American manufacturing, was you press the button, we do the rest. And this does not apply only in cameras, but also in washing machines or refrigerators. They all follow the same standards, or in cars. You buy a car, you buy a washing machine, you buy a refrigerator, you know how to use it. You don't need the manual. Imagine if the Japanese companies had taken over the standards for car manufacturing. If they were the first, or if they had overtaken American companies early on in the game. Every car would need its own manual to operate. And Americans attacked back. And this is now becoming the new standard. You press the button, it does the rest. Okay, listen carefully to this part right now.
Not my agency. My agency, if it wasn't perfect, and I'm not talking about content, I'm talking about technically perfect, they would boot it. They'd boot it back to you. They'd go, you got this problem, that problem. So the first shoot I ever do from them, I'm shooting 5D Canon, and I'm shooting 35 millimeter and 120 film. It was a portrait. I do these things. I'm all excited. I got agency representation. They approached me a year before. They said, we've seen your work. We like you. We're going to watch you for a year. And then we're going to come back and we're either going to say, hey, man, you're amazing. Or they're going to be like, you suck. You fooled us. And then I would not have representation. They came back a year later. They're like, you're the guy. I signed a global exclusive with them to do this one kind of work. First shoot, bang away on the 5D, a bang away on the 35 and the 120. I package it all up. I send it in. The digital files all get rejected. And I'm like, God, that's weird. I hear nothing about the film. So when they reject the digital, I'm thinking, oh, they rejected the film. They even saw that it was film and they were insulted and they just didn't even comment on it because they're like, you're an idiot living in 1975. Why are you sending us film in 2005? I'm like, really? You rejected my digital files? They're perfect. What could be wrong with them? So I take a raw file. I send it to the technicians at the agency. They do their corrections to it and they FTP the raw file back to me. And there are 22 corrections to my file. 22. I will remember 22 steps that they had to do to a 5D file to get it right. Now, I'm thinking, how is this possible? Those backlit, 100 speed, great lens, no one else has ever complained about this. And then I open the raw file and I look, and every single thing that they brought up was there. I had just never looked that closely before, nor had anyone else. Now, my photographer friends who are with other agencies are they're enraged by this whole thing because they're shooting the same cameras and their agencies haven't said anything. And I said, I can almost guarantee you that your images have the same problem as mine and you haven't looked at them that closely either. Things like chromatic aberration, purple fringing, red fringing, etc. It went on and on and on. And oh, by the way, to get rid of chromatic aberration and purple fringing and red fringing, you have to run software applications on those files. Sure, you get rid of red fringing and purple fringing, but that same software application that got rid of the fringing creates another problem. So you have to buy another piece of software that then corrects for that. Same for chromatic aberration. And I am sitting there 3 months. I get these images rejected over and over and over. And I'm like, for the love of God, why did I become a photographer? This is the dumbest thing I could have possibly done. My father wanted me to be an investment banker. And now I'm like, he was a genius. He knew this was coming and I was too dumb to see it. And so now I'm like, okay, what am I gonna do? So I finally get the digital files accepted 3 months down the road. And I call my editor back and I said, just out of morbid curiosity, I sent you film files at the same time. And before I can even inquire, she goes, oh yeah, they're perfect. They're already in. Just send us. She goes, if you want to shoot film, we would love it. Just send us film. Those files are perfect.
And now listen to this segment carefully.
So the point is, 40 rolls of 220 a day or less, film was cheaper. 40 rolls of 220 a day or more, and digital had the potential of saving you money. The second that people found that out, a lot of clients went back to film because film had better skin tone, had better latitude, had less lab time. Processing and scanning costs were nothing compared to the digital technician costs. That when this whole basically revolution popped, when this bubble popped, many of those labs didn't entirely go away, but their digital departments went from like 40 people to 4 because clients were like, why are we paying so much for this stuff? Just shoot film.
So to them, digital photography increased the cost because they had to have technicians to fix the images. For us, it increased the time, therefore also the cost, to reach perfect prints and know how to produce them each and every time. All these factors combined create a necessity for brand loyalty, for the hobbyists at least, in order to avoid relearning a new system and to avoid producing inconsistent photographs. I have a full-time job. I cannot spend, let's say, 5 weeks in a row learning how to produce perfect prints from a Nikon system, and then all of a sudden switch to something else and repeat the whole process from scratch. See, part of the big lie on YouTube and it's not intentional most of the time, is that we look images on a screen. A screen is like a flashlight. It flashes the light on our faces. We get overwhelmed and we see things and we say, oh, this is nice, and we overlook the errors. So people are going to say, this is such a nice image, but it's not really nice because in real life, her chin is not green. And let me tell you, if I print this image, it appears more green than it appears on the screen, and it shows directly. It hits you on your face. Now, with my system that I've already invested the time to learn how to fix these errors quickly, I can do it quickly. If you force me into a new system, I will have to now waste the time to learn the attributes of the new lens and how to correct the new profiles. And I'm not willing to spend the rest of my life in front of a computer trying to figure out the personal anomalies of every programmer out there. Now, in my opinion, I'm just throwing this out there, this should be more like a normal spread of money spent on photography and general activities that also produce pictures. Because if photography is a method to record your experiences, how will you have experiences if most money goes to gear? So let's now examine the factors that raise the cost of digital photography without any gains. And I'm always talking about the hobbyist market here, right? The amateur market. And the number one is failing to distinguish between the value of a photograph versus technical accuracy. Example. This is a technically great image shot with a D850 and the Milvus 135. And one can pixel peep all they want. However, this is a valuable photograph shot many years ago with a pocket compact Canon 5 megapixel camera. I mean, between these two, if the house is burning down, which one do you think that I will run to save? Number two, paying a lot of money for marginal improvements when a cheap flash would have done the trick much better even than the improved version. Example, no flash with flash. That's an image now that's much easier to edit, right? No flash. And the shadows, you have to recover shadows, you have to do this, you have to do that. These images usually have a harsh color too. Flash. 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 This guy is taking wedding pictures without a flash by setting them in the light, in the sunlight directly. Unrecoverable. Flash. Little flash. Little flash. Lots of flash. And this is going to be just fine when it's print. And I can always turn it just a little bit down. But do me a favor here. In this image here, I want you to do me a favor, because on my monitor it looks fine, but when I move it to another monitor that is not wide gamut, it looks yellowish. So let me know how it looks in your monitor. Number three, believing in theories on magical lenses, magical cameras, etc. The truth is that it all boils down to the shooting conditions, the light, and the color profiles, which differ between manufacturers, your software program, the this, the that. It is true that some lenses are better, much better than some other lenses, but they're not dramatically better to the point that, oh my God, I cannot believe this image and this and that. And number four, and that's a big one, is the lifestyle concept. It reminds me of Nike advertisements that if you buy their shoes, you're going to become a top basketball player. You just need the shoes. The lifestyle concept and the cameras that satisfy the lifestyle. Leaving Leica aside, this is now the queen of the lifestyle cameras. A $2,000 crop camera, body only. If I want discreet street photography, that's the camera. It fits in a pocket with the lens. It's got a zoom lens and it's stabilized. Versus the Fuji, which with the lens is going to cost five times as much, $2,500, and it needs a bag. That Panasonic is 20 megapixels, and what you see here are 5 megapixel images from a camera made in 2003, 5 megapixels. But let me tell you why I am not a street photographer in the United States. In June 12, 2020, this year, F. Stoppers hosted this article and probably this video. I haven't seen the video, to tell you the truth. Why do they look so good compared to American music videos? Well, it's not only about the color science, vibrant, lively, youthful colors. 1 year before the F. Stoppers article, I had posted a video and it had the title, "Let's Find the Charm Again, Use Arms and Hands." Now, the songwriters are Westerners and all the presentation and the production has Western standards. So what do they have in these cultures that we have lost in the West? Have you seen a photograph like this ever from professional and artistic photographers in the US in old abandoned buildings and stuff like that? Something that is aesthetically pleasing and sophisticated without being provocative. At least lately, have you seen anything like that? And that is what I said in an old video, that it's not only cinematographers, but we have a lot to learn from choreographers in theme photography. These are all written by Western songwriters. Yet they have something missing from the West, both the EU and the US and Australia, in the last decades. They're charming and optimistic. That's what's missing nowadays, because modern trends in Western pop, they are charmless, pessimistic.
I think the reason that the franchise has been so successful for 30-something years, well, the thing that makes it so unique as well, is because it's an optimistic view of the future. Everything else that we see is so pessimistic and so dark and so nihilistic. And this shows a positive portrayal of what could be in the future. And I think people need that and want that. And want that to grasp on.
Because our standards have changed too. We went from this to this. It's fucking ugly. And it's not about how people dress. It's the feeling, the emotion that they portray. This is a very charming image. Right? Excellent. Beautiful. This by Elliot Erwitt. Probably my favorite street photographer. Absolutely beautiful. This is interesting and classy at the same time. We don't have these kind of subjects anymore. And that is why you see many photographers and they travel to other countries for street photography. And you wonder, what the hell, don't you have streets in your city? The people are not interesting anymore. The whole arrangement. Where are you gonna find these characters anymore in Europe or the United States? Study this image carefully by Elliot Erwitt, and what you see in the faces of these three women, the four women, is integrity and character. And here you see integrity and character. And here you see integrity and character. And here you see integrity and character. Even in this one, integrity and character. We've lost these two things, and we also lost our charm in the West. But not entirely, though. You can still find charm in selected places and selected activities, one of which can be photography too. And it means different things to different people. What it means to me, well, since I was in my youth a ballroom dancer, I can illustrate it with a video that I found. Notice the frame that is formed by the shoulders and the arms always stay constant. The dancers smile and the dresses are always unique, one of a kind each. If I had the money that I've spent on dresses for my partners, I would have a fully paid house by now. So for me at least, the whole issue of street photography in the West is dead and buried unless you only photograph old people who still maintain some of the old world charm, or if you're a photojournalist. And it just popped in my head, I didn't plan for this, but I just remembered it. This promotional video of Overgaard for Leica and stuff, where he goes in a few squares in Europe and takes street photographs. Now, would you ever photograph these two guys here? Probably not, right? Anything from here? Nah, right?
I have something where it's timeless.
This guy, that's what I mean. If you watch this promotional video, every other character, you would never take a picture of them. Even the ones that appear to be colorful, they look very pretentious and fake. This guy is real. That's exactly what I mean. We don't have that anymore. Still, I would take a few photos of my area, you know, for documentary purposes, let's say, but I wouldn't really buy a new camera for this. And even if I wanted a new camera for this, I wouldn't get another camera that needs a bag, such as this one, because with a lens it needs a bag. I would go with something that fits in a pocket, and it's completely unobtrusive and almost invisible. And don't tell me things about sensor size and stuff like that, because these are 5 megapixel images from 2007 with that little compact camera. What more do you need for street shots and stuff? And finally, of course, that the most popular channels and blogs are all about gear. Somebody invented the CMOS sensor and now we all have to buy new gear every 2 years, although the old one would still take the same exact pictures because the subjects out there haven't changed. I mean, people always said when they visited stores, I don't like salesmen because they're too pushy. And nowadays we invite them inside our homes via YouTube. We open up YouTube and even if we're watching something completely irrelevant, there's advertisement of salesmen inside our homes 24/7. The short and long-term losses, you know them, time and money, a lot of time and a lot of money, failure to learn photography because most time is wasted on gear reviews, and enormous cost per photograph, per keeper, per print. The two big shockers for me were first of all this video and this print, and I have shown you the actual print. That was the biggest shocker, because this print is 21.6 by 39.3. It is 50% larger than a 20 by 30. And I have shown you the actual print. And this was created from a 20 megapixel crop from the D810, which means that if I had accurately framed the image with a D750, so I didn't have to crop, I would have had more pixels and bigger pixels within the same huge print, 50% larger than 20 by 30. That was the biggest shocker. And with a manual focus lens, which I'm not entirely sure if I focused it accurately to begin with. Now, in the United States, we always find reasons to buy things. But lately, I'm in a mode of selling things, minimizing, aggressively. And you can see the reasons in red. But I do see commercials of lenses and cameras and new gizmos that are out there. I always ask myself three questions. Number one, did I ever in my lifetime miss a good shot because I didn't have this thing? If I haven't missed a shot yet, no reason to buy it. I will buy it when I start missing shots because I don't have it. Number two, will I have to change my lifestyle and shooting style just to accommodate the accessory? Like these remote controls. Did I ever in my lifetime left my camera and tripod 50 meters away, remotely controlling it via phone? No. Why would I do it now? Did I ever miss it? No. And number three, will I have to carry yet another thing with me, which will make my life more complicated and will turn photography from enjoyment into work? And now the section you have all been waiting for. Prove me I'm wrong. If you're really into shooting birds with a great keeper rate, is buying a super duper system the first thing to do? Absolutely not. The first thing to do is to move to Florida, because that's where the birds are. I bought the 200 to 500 for my daughter. She used it twice. That's it. And only on the condition that I would carry around that stuff. If you're in Illinois trying to buy gear to shoot birds, where the hell are the birds? The subject comes first. If you don't have the subject, you don't even need a camera. See, that's what the gear mania does. If you don't have the subject, or if you don't have the time, or if you don't have the lifestyle, the number one country in the history of this solar system in purchasing of home gym equipment, expensive gym memberships, or gym memberships in general, good quality walkways, especially in the suburbs, and bike paths, is the United States. And at the same time, it is the number one country among the big developed ones in obesity rate. But it's closely followed by, look at this, Qatar, Libya, Turkey, Egypt, Lebanon, United Arab Emirates. There goes the myth of the Mediterranean diet as well. Because if you sit on your ass all day eating Mediterranean diet or any other diet, you'll get fat. And Canada is not that far behind. So we gotta dispel of these myths and look what actually happens in our lives. In our lives, you get something new, a new piece of something. Even a bread maker. People bought bread makers. Now with the coronavirus crisis, how many homemade breads have you seen in your neighborhood? 9 out of 10 people who bought them, they have them sitting on the kitchen counter with a manual outside waiting for somebody to read it. Because you need the ingredients and you need the time to do it. If you want to do it. If it's one of your priorities. If you're going to give time to do it. I know that there are influences out there and temptations. And thank God that my gas was in photography and not in motorcycles. Otherwise, I would have had 3 motorcycles right now in my living room. We stay too much indoors, and that makes YouTube really attractive, and we bombard ourselves voluntarily with all this news and all this gear, and at the end, we all think about gear. Remember a few weeks ago, I went for 1 week in Wisconsin, didn't check any internet during that time, so no photo channels either. We hardly stayed at the hotel at all. We were always outside. I came back with lots of pictures and then sold even a couple more lenses that I figured that were practically useless to me for what I do. And maybe I will become the only photo channel that will be against gear purchases, unless somebody absolutely needs something because they're failing at what they're doing. And that will make me very unpopular, which is not bad, because under the radar, that's where the best pictures are. Thanks a lot. Bye.